initiatives that are meant to help the grassroots person. And most of the initiatives have not succeeded because we've not had people with cooperative knowledge on how to bring people together in form of a cooperative Nobe Sako to manage them. So what ought to be done by the NRM regime so that we can see the cooperative colleges being empowered so that perhaps they can come up with programs to give hands-on training for all those various groups, all those various initiatives, the ones who are manning it, so that now we can see that whatever program that is coming out is really benefiting the people.
Thank you very much, Comrade Mazima Akol. I want to begin from an angle that cooperative education in Uganda may not be as popular as we would have loved it to be. Why? Probably not enough awareness has been created among the communities, because our biggest challenge right now is the nature and structure of our society. The structure, we are structured in such a way that we are a bit we are largely a community or a society that is diverse in nature. Diverse in terms of culture, diverse in terms of geographical location, diverse in terms of the way of life of individuals depending on society that we live in. Now, if you look at the nature of our society structured in that way, it therefore communicates to all of us the need for a strategy that can be able to ensure that we look for things that make us similar as a society, as a people, and use them to bring the people together. If I am from the Atekere people, the Nilo Hamites, and you have the Bantu, you have the Luo, and others, we must forge a way, first in terms of how do we make these people relate together. Because for you to have a cooperative is an organization of relationship. It is relationships that bring us together. So you find that the cooperative education is something very critical for this country to forge its national unity, which is in line with our promise to the people of Uganda in terms of our principle as NRM. But it's also important in that if we are to develop economically, it is this education that can be able to spur development, economic development in this country, and be able to raise our GDP levels in terms of increasing the productivity of the people. Because in a cooperative, you find that those that are lazy can be able to be pulled by those that are hardworking. Unfortunately, I think the Minister of Education, I don't work for government, I work for a political party, but I think the Minister of Education
the political party is the ruling party.
The ruling party, yes. But you see, of course, there's a difference between a political party and government. Why? Because we design programs as a political party. Unfortunately, we do not restrict those who implement to be only NRM. So it is all Ugandans that we task in government, those who are working in government, those that believe in NRM and those who don't believe, to be able to implement on some of these programs. So you find that the challenge that we have is that I think, one, there is no much awareness. If, for example, if you tried to walk around this country and ask them whether they are aware there is a cooperative college that teaches people about cooperative education, I think very few may actually give positive answers. Why? Maybe there is little awareness that has been done, but it is not too late. I believe as an organization, as NRM, we are going to play our part using our structures across the country to ensure that this comes out. Why? Because when you look at our manifesto of 2016, 2021, then 2021, 2026, you actually realize that revival of cooperatives is at the center of our economic, is at the center of ensuring that the 68% of the people of Uganda who are not in the money economy should be brought to money economy. So I think it is something that we as a political party are going to ensure that we prioritize in terms of awareness, but most importantly, how do we structure education of cooperatives? Because you see, you have people who are going to school. those are the young those are the young ones, sorry. Those are the young ones. But you have people who are already out of school, but maybe they are doing one thing or the other, or they are not even doing anything at all. So you have a community that is already into production. You have a community that may also not be in production, but would want to increase the awareness about the importance of cooperative education, so that maybe in one way or the other, they can be part of this movement of the cooperatives, but also most importantly, they can be able to take their children for this very important education. So I think it is something that we all must take seriously as a country.
Well, thank you very much, Augustine Otuko. And this takes me to Francis. Francis, you are a senior lecturer at Uganda Cooperative College Kigumba. Actually, it's not the only one. We also have Uganda Cooperative College Tororo. Yes, but Uganda Cooperative College Kigumba started in 1954, being the premier cooperative college in Eastern Central Africa. Tanzania began theirs in Moshi, actually, where the president had the opportunity also to teach in 1963. Kenya also started theirs in the 60s. But we see the Cooperative College of Moshi is now a university, even offering PhDs in cooperative studies. That one of Kenya is now a cooperative university offering even master's programs. What has happened to Kigumba that actually it has stalled?
I wouldn't say I'm giving a textbook answer, but this is just a personal opinion. Fortunately, Mr. Mazima, I've been to all the three colleges, or the two universities and our college where I work. One thing I should say that has been responsible for the state of the cooperative college currently, you see, you cannot detach the college from socioeconomic affairs of the country. Partly, I almost want to incline to Augustine, where the politics has not been that nice, it cannot spare certain things. Because cooperatives, like he has said, it is issues or relationships where you go into business as people working together. So, where we have a diversity, that's why you would, those of us who are a bit old, we had cooperative giants in the 60s and 70s. If you went to Acholi, you would find East Acholi Cooperative Union. If you went to Bugisu, Bugisu Cooperative. So all parts of the country were touched. And therefore, anybody talking about cooperatives that time, even if you are from Kabale, you would have something to refer to. Now, the Cooperative College happens to be the training arm of the cooperative department and the cooperative movement. Permit me to just make a slight clarification on this. The cooperative movement is made up of people who just rise from nowhere and say, we are tobacco farmers. Let's come together and see how to get value from our tobacco. That is now the cooperative movement. The other side is the cooperative department, which is now government, coming in to play its role of regulation and supervision and all this. Now, the cooperative college happens to be a uniting factor in terms of training human resource for both the cooperative movement and government departments. Now, you'll bear me witness, Bwana Mazima, at one time the cooperative department had only two staff. That was just the commissioner and his assistant. And this is not long ago. So what would this mean? The cooperative affairs, rather the cooperative college affairs, were directly under the supervision of the commissioner for cooperative development. But you can imagine one person with his assistant to oversee a national institution. That is just one aspect of where we have been. After Augustine, his NRM and our NRM coming to power, there were now drives. Should I say to resuscitate or to revive? Meaning something was in limbo state. And this limbo state, Mr. Mazma, you'll bear me witness, it started as early as around 1975. You'll know why. Because that is, I think, when we started experiencing excess economic decline. Now, this one could not spare an institution whose strength was partly from the movement and partly from government, because both sides we are actually weakening. Up to, I would comfortably say, up to around 85 or 86, I would say so. Because that was a period, and that is over 10 years, of actual decline. Nothing progressive.
About a decade.
If not more. Mm. I'm just trying to say about a decade. Mm. And if a decade is 10 years, now you are saying, why is it that the other side
that
thinks
that,
are, yes,
that started much later,
exactly,
have actually developed, have moved?
Thank you very much. I'm yet to understand whether these two countries, these two sister countries, have seriously had what I would call political and economic turmoil. I stand to be informed. So this has been part of what are the strengths in the other side. Now, under the...
Maybe if I can come in.
Please.
Because we've had a country like Nigeria.
Right.
Nigeria, I think until recently, it was also a country that was characterized by political turmoil.
Mm.
But we see the education system was not affected by the political turmoil, because they have more than three cooperative universities. Yet around the same time, when we started our own cooperative college, there are also colleges just like we have, but now they have about three cooperative universities.
Thank you very much for that information. Still, I'm not yet convinced that there would have been a possibility of detaching our, I'm talking of our, meaning Uganda Cooperative College. And I've told you the genesis was actually pegged on those two pillars. Elsewhere, I stand to be informed. Now, if those two pillars, it's like you and your wife, if you have been the breadwinners in the home, and things go wrong on either your side or both sides in this case, chances are that the family will starve. So, back to the issue. Kenya Cooperative University, fortunately, I've also studied in that place. I've also studied at Moshi itself. Partly, like Augustine said, the relationship with those institutions and governments in power, quote me right, governments in power have always been prosperous, whereby you come up with a strategic plan, 5-10 years, and those who have designed it, like now from the political side, are in harmony with those who are implementing it. Chances are you'll post success. And this is exactly what has happened. I was once in, it used to be called Kenya Cooperative College. I was there when it was still a college.
Now Kenya Cooperative University.
It is now Kenya Cooperative University. Mm-hmm. But you would see that even the paternalistic relationship from the state was visible, which was not the case for our place for those many years. And two, we have also had some, I would call it, mixed actions.
Mm.
You remember, Augustine will, I think, bear with me. At one time, the Cooperative College was under the Ministry of Cooperatives. Then somewhere between, it crossed to the Ministry of Education and Sports.
Mm.
But when that happened, those of us who were on the ground did not see support also taking shift from the other side to
the Ministry of Education.
So
yes.
Actually, at some point, we were like an orphaned college.
You are neither in education
Kabisa.
Nor in the Ministry of Trade and Cooperatives.
Correct. It was there, and my colleagues will bear me witness. Not until it's like now about 10 years ago, when we now emphatically belonged to Ministry of Education.
So I think for the 10 years, you had no sense of belonging.
We were orphaned.
You're just tugging it here. Now let's get to Augustine, because as a research officer of the ruling National Resistance Movement, don't you think it's very important that all Ukadas from grassroots to national level, they should have some kind of cooperative knowledge, because cooperatives are associations for people, bring together people who have something in common.
Mm-hmm.
And so that perhaps we can see the structures of the party being precursors to development, showing a good example of how exactly cooperative movements should work and how they should be managed.
Thank you very much. Mm. First, allow me respond to my senior lecturer's comment on 10 years of orphanage. Mm.
Yeah.
I want to say that progressively, reforms have been carried out in government, and these reforms are discussed and clearly understood. There was something that some Ugandans and those that study policy and those that are able to visit other countries and benchmark who are starting to question, because you are a cooperative college, but you are dealing with the education of the people.
Mm.
There was also an element of the nursing schools.
Mm.
Nursing schools, the agricultural schools, and many others.
Mm.
These institutions are all dealing with one aspect called education. So there was a mismatch in understanding and saying that why should an education institution belong to another ministry, and yet probably we have what we, not probably, we actually have a Ministry of Education that must be able to manage all the education institutions in Uganda. And I think this was a strategic decision that was taken. The transition will always have its challenges because it is not only Chigumba that had challenges, because We've been able to interact with several institutions, and we realized that at the process of transition, there were challenges of, first of all, of acceptability from the ministry.
Correct.
Because
realigning
the bureaucrats, and so on and so forth, but also in terms of budgeting, shifting of budgets from different ministries to align them with the Ministry of Education. Some bureaucrats were against it because probably they were benefiting from some of these budgets that were meant for institutions. And I think that probably could have contributed to the suffering of some of the institutions in the process of transition. But I'm happy to know that after that transition was managed, the Ministry of Education has taken charge of all the education institutions in Uganda. And I think it's something important for the country, because we cannot have institutions scattered here and there. It shows that we don't understand exactly what we are doing, because in terms of supervision, the education ministry must be able to supervise all those institutions that deal with matters of education.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the question that coming back to the question that you asked, the question was how we as NRM, how do we intend to ensure that the cooperative education is propelled through our structural
cooperative
system.
Knowledge.
Cooperative knowledge,
yes.
Is propelled through our structural system.
Mm-hmm.
I must state that if you look at most of our documents, this discussion of revival of cooperatives, to the extent of ensuring that it is captured in policy documents and also in terms of budgeting, these matters were discussed first in the party. In the party structure, it began with our policy organ called SEC, and when these discussions later translated into government discussion, for us, we believed as a party we had done our part in terms of influencing.
Mm-hmm.
But I think you raise a very important matter of how the party can use its structural system to raise to benefit more from the cooperative knowledge. And I think, as a political party, we are happy that now we have a new Secretary General who has already taken over office.
Mm-hmm.
These are matters that will be discussed and should be advanced, and see how do we raise more awareness in terms of cooperative knowledge. But most importantly, how can we as a political party and government utilize Chigumba as an institution to do more of reach out to the community? Because you see, we as a political party, we may not have people who are highly knowledgeable in terms of cooperatives, but we can be able to hire Chigumba as an institution, or lecturers of Chigumba as facilitators. We mobilize, our biggest strength as a political party is to mobilize the communities.
Mm.
We can be able to do this and be able to raise more awareness. I can give you an example. I have carefully studied, we as in the political party, we have carefully studied the issue of SACCOs in Uganda.
Mm.
We have injected a lot of money in the savings and the savings. How do you call them?
SACCOs.
Yes, savings and credit cooperatives.
Mm.
We have injected a lot of money, but the survival rate of these organizations has been very minimal. And yet the revolutionary leader, our party chairman, has been very, very emphatic in terms of ensuring that we get people out of poverty through these groupings called the saving and credit. Unfortunately, the challenge we have been facing as government, as a political party, is that we mobilize people using the political language and say, guys, can we get in two circles? These people get in two circles. As soon as they get support from government or from any donor organization, you find that this money is shared or somebody has run with it. They don't understand the beauty of strengthening an organization that they have created as a group. So we have not done enough, I must confess, in terms of ensuring that we instill better knowledge of managing cooperative societies. The Minister of Trade, for example, is overwhelmed. I will give you an example of recent. When a Mioga came, the requirement was that people must create a cooperative society.
A group and association.
Mm. And the purpose for this was to ensure that we support those who are doing something, because Mioga was simply for those who are already doing something. Those who are in borders, those who are in saloon, and so on and so forth. Unfortunately, you find that the Minister of Trade, I think, was first of all not prepared enough to manage the numbers. So the level of preparation across the country was not enough in terms of those instilling knowledge of managing. That's why you find, for example, in my region there, the group that received money in Kalaki for Mioga, it's only two people who ran away with the money. Why? Because they did not know the beauty and understanding that if you manage this credit saving and credit circle carefully, this society carefully, they would be able to grow it, and it becomes probably a bank in the near future, like Equity, like Centenary Bank that started as a saving and credit society. So these are ideas that can only be managed by the institution like Chigumba and many others that deal with matters of cooperatives. And I think it is something that we are going to take seriously as a political party, so that we can influence departments of government to prioritize matters of awareness for society. As I said before, we are dealing with two forms of education. We have what we call the formal education, which they are dealing with. But there is also informal education,
and also the non-formal.
Yes, the non-formal.
You have informal and the non-formal.
Yes, so you have the informal and the non-formal. Mm-hmm. But when you look at the informal and the non-formal, this is almost 80-90% of society is in that cluster of society. Mm-hmm. So I think, as an organization, Chigumba and many other responsible departments must be able to design programs that target more of those that are not going to class, because they are the ones that are running the economy. If you went to Chikuwo, those guys will never go back to class, but they need this knowledge so that they can be able to build institutions, build organizations, build societies that are going to propel economic development.
Well, if you can hold on to your point, Ndugu Augustine Otuko. Yes, Francis.
Yes.
He raises a very key issue that, you know, universities and tertiary institutions are supposed to mainly do three things: teach, do research, and also have outreach programs. But unfortunately, most high institutions of learning concentrate on only teaching. Very few have actually managed to do research, and actually there could be none that even does outreach. And this is now where cooperative college needs to come in, especially on the part of outreach, like Otuko says. Because now somebody is in Chikuwo may never go back to class, but they need that cooperative knowledge. I'll give a case in point. You find three people have just graduated from school. The other one's father has big land that is vast.
Right.
The other one's father has a tractor. And the other one's father can access a loan for them. So instead of these three people coming together in form of cooperation and say, look, let us start production. So don't you think really at all levels, primary, secondary, tertiary institutions, and also outreach programs, we need something on cooperative education?
Thank you very much, Mr. Cole. On all the three parameters, I think we score differently. But as Augustine said, when it comes to the actual, okay, what he called the formal education, I think there we really score a pass mark. When it comes to outreach, because of what has what I've just explained, 4 years ago, Uganda Cooperative College went into that direction, which had never been the case earlier. So we went into that direction and we opened five outreach centers. Uganda Cooperative College Kigumba is based in Kiryandongo. So one of the centers we established was in Kampala, another one in Mbarara, another one in Mbale, another one in Gulu. And we also had another outreach center in Kigumba. You'll ask me why. For these guys who are not through the formal education. Now, what are the challenges? The challenges are, like you had earlier.
Maybe, if you can hold on to your point, we shall be going in for a short break. Right. And when we come back, you shall take it from there.
Thank you.
We've cut and reduced our MTN Momo withdrawal rates. Now, you can withdraw mobile money at the lowest rates. You also get MTN Centure points when you deposit, send, and withdraw MTN mobile money. Visit our Momo agents countrywide and withdraw mobile money at our reduced rates from 1st May 2021. Everywhere you go, MTN.
Everyone, my name is Derek Aina Dasha.
And my name is Anne Taylor.
Together we are
Lucky 3 Brand Ambassador. We want to let you know that this time we are bigger, better, and easier. Simply dial *185*88# and select Lucky 3.
The order of the three numbers doesn't matter. Any order you give us, you stand a chance of working out with the weekly jackpot.
Don't forget to catch the show on Magic One HD.
UBC TV every Tuesday at exactly 7:30 p.m. Lucky 3 Chisoboka.
It is possible.
Patriotism is a feeling of love, devotion, and the willingness to sacrifice for one's country.
I say no to corruption because I put my country first. I choose peace over violence because I put my country first.
Patriotic, Uganda first. This message is brought to you by the National Secretariat for Patriotism Co. Uganda, Office of the President.
Thank you.
college aimed at empowering people, even those that are not in education.
Emphasize the issue which you had raised of outreach centers, because the outreach centers, besides catering for the formal education, also have room for the other type of education for the guys who are not coming for going for certificates and diplomas just to look for jobs. Now, as I told you, we tried, and this is 4 years ago, went out and opened 5 centers. But the challenge, like Augustine said earlier, what traveling into a ground full of landmines. What do I mean? You can imagine that what has been and what continues to be posted are the negatives about cooperatives. In fact, some people have even the guts to say cooperatives died. I think you have heard such talk. Now, my father used to say, never talk of a good doctor who is responsible for many patients dying from there. So we are going into a territory with which is full of mixed messages. Most of the messages, bad messages. Fortunately, as Augustine said, I can say for the last three to four years, the message is beginning to be positive. When you read today's new vision, and I've carried one with me, Mr. Biamazima, you will find that currently there is resuscitation and revival. So that now when you talk of a cooperative being an institution which can help people, people in Teso will say, ah, even my oranges, this is now where we are selling, and we are even testing the Teju, the Jays. So now the message can be well received. So it goes back to what Augustine said. The message needs to go down to the grassroots of trying to enlighten people about the attributes that we can get from cooperatives. So that was one of the issues which we were experiencing, but we are like good cadres. We have not lost the fight. But also you realize that particularly the media is very good at capturing the other side, the dark side of a coin. But I wish also the good stories concerning cooperatives could come out. If you went to Western Uganda and particularly Kasese, people of Nyakato's cooperative union don't talk of another thing, because they have been with it, they have guarded it, they have also guarded it against it.
Just like Bugisu.
Exactly. Bugisu was actually also resuscitated. It is now a coffee, one of the leading coffee exporters. Now, when you're in Mbale and you talk ill of cooperatives, you are not likely to get a good audience.
Just like in Kasese, because they have a very good example of Nyakatonzi.
Very good. Yes, yes. So you are not. So the ground is beginning also to be supportive of what we should now depend on to strategically venture into the unknown future.
Well, thank you very much, Francis. Yes, Augustine. Now, of course, now looking at Uganda, how do we develop cooperative education? We've seen our colleagues who came and benchmarked us, Kenya and Tanzania, have actually moved a step. Now, how do we develop this Kigumba Cooperative College, in your view? Because fortunately, there is a plan by government for every region to have a public university. In Teso, we already have one. In Lango, they have. In Rwenzori, actually, Mountains of the Moon is at the verge of being taken over by government. In Kabale, they have one. In West Nile, in Acholi. Now, in good enough, Kigumba Cooperative College is within Bunyoro. Don't you think that could be an opportune time for Bunyoro to provide us the first cooperative university in Uganda?
Well, thank you. Maybe before I answer that question about whether we should make Kigumba a public university for Bunyoro or not, because I think I will answer that. What I think maybe to pick from Francis is that we seem to be propelling more of dark news about our country.
Yes.
We love more negative news than positive news.
True.
In Uganda, we know that there are those cooperatives that have survived. Those those that were actually even trying to fail at some point,
yes,
government was able to come in, right, and injected some
to give them a stimulus,
yes, stimulus package, mm, to enable them to revive them, so that members of the of such cooperatives are supported. Mm. And I believe, as he says, Bugisu Cooperative Union is one of the top most. Why? Yes. Because government had also a hand in it, in ensuring that they support them. I've also seen the fruit cooperative union that has come up in Teso, that negotiates with the UDA, that has been UDC, Uganda Development Corporation, mm, has been part of the voice of the farmers, mm, the cooperative union of the fruit factory, irrespective of the challenges, because when we met them recently, most of them were actually saying what they now need is the expansion of the capacity of the fruit factory in Soroti, because they mobilized so many people to get into the fruit farming,
yeah,
and the capacity of the factory is so minimal,
right,
that they should be able, they're asking government now to expand the capacity. And I think this collective advocacy, this collective negotiation with government is yields more fruits faster than when we have isolated voices speaking left and right.
Mm-hmm.
And I think whoever still doubts the beauty and success and the strength of cooperative unions in Africa, in Uganda, in the world, should actually rethink and be able to read widely to, mm-hmm, understand the beauty of having these cooperative unions. And I think I will encourage all leaders in this country, from LOC1 to different levels,
mm,
irrespective of the political colors,
mm,
as long as you are a leader in society, including religious leaders, cultural leaders, we should be able to continue educating. Because I believe if we left this education,
mm,
to only government, to only Chigumba,
mm,
they will not be able to, mm, because we are a population of 41 million people. We are 75,000 villages in this country. So these are big administrative units that,
mm,
that if we left the responsibility to only Chigumba, they will not be able to manage. And my view is that we as a people, as a country, should collectively be responsible enough to continue educating people in any platform. It may be church, it may be a cultural gathering, it may be in a barrio, to ensure that we encourage our people to have basic knowledge, basic understanding of the merits and demerits of cooperative unions. Now, coming back to whether we should make Chigumba a public university, I think this is a decision that
public cooperative, actually the only cooperative
university. The only cooperative university.
I
think this is a strategic decision, mm, that will be taken by the leadership of the party. However, there have been conversations, because there are a lot of proposals already coming from Bunyoro. There are those that are saying, well, since Bunyoro does not have a public university,
mm-hmm,
Chigumba should be translated into a public university for Bunyoro region. However, there are also those that disagree with it, and these are all voices that are coming from one region, and that is, there are those who are saying, no, let this public university be located in Hoima. But I believe with the trust I have in the leadership, they will be able to listen to all these voices, make considerations before taking a strategic decision. But I think the proposal of having one cooperative university in Uganda,
mm-hmm,
coming from Chigumba, even if Bunyoro had a public university, for me, I still believe we can still have Chigumba translated into a university. Why? Because across the world, even if you go to China, America, where, you will find that there are universities that are strategical, or there are institutions that are strategically established, but intended to raise a workforce that will sustain the economy of a country. And I think Chigumba should be considered as one of those that should be able to come and help us raise personnel that can be able to raise a strategic, to sustain our economy now and years to come. However, if that does not work, government could also have another option: introduce cooperative courses in all public universities.
As even course units.
So that we can be able to have everyone, irrespective of whether you are an engineer, whether you are a doctor, whether you, because cooperatives are for everybody.
Definitely.
So I think it would be important for government to to revisit their decisions and be able to make considerations so that we can be able to have every university, every citizen of this country that goes through a formal education having knowledge about cooperative management.
Well, thank you very much, Otok Augustine. Yes, Francis.
Yes.
Yeah, you are privileged that you went to Kenya Cooperative College, University.
Right.
You also went to Moshi.
Right.
And these are institutions that began after our own Chigumba. So apart from the political will, because you see that they enjoyed political will in their respective countries, what else were they doing that you feel actually should be done by Chigumba, should be done by stakeholders in education, so that we can see Chigumba playing that role for which it was established? It's because of Kenya Cooperative University and Moshi Cooperative University that we actually in Kenya and Tanzania, their cooperatives are a bit stable, more stable as compared to, just because they have now the human resource, the manpower. So what is it that they were doing or that we are not doing that we should do so that we can also catch up with them?
Thank you very much. I still want to refer the success of an institution which aims at a particular type of training should be matching with the those institutions. Like you have just said, the cooperatives in Kenya, my goodness, the cooperatives in Tanzania, when you get there, you feel actually almost all aspects of life are managed through cooperatives. Now, when you come back here and you hear Augustine and the political party he's here for, standing in here for, talking about Mioga?
Mioga.
To me, Mioga is just enterprise-based, okay?
Yes.
Now, which part of Uganda doesn't have people who are involved in some form of enterprise? It's not there. You'll find carpenters, you'll find mechanics, you'll find... Now, if the cooperative college can be helped to can be supported to have that conversation with those guys, the political wing, which is actually spreading a good message over this, and they work as partners, I can see the future being very bright. In any case, already, like he has said, the conversations where we eavesdrop, I think we are not about to lose it. Even if it doesn't come from anywhere, already there are also conversations at a higher level with the National Council for Higher Education, having also realized the need for Uganda Cooperative College being developed to university level. Also, back at the college, the administration is not sitting. We hatched the approach of affiliation, and several conversations are going on with the different universities. Unfortunately, let me call it unfortunate, including affiliating with the MUCOPS, which is Moshi University of Cooperatives, and also Kenya Cooperative University. And some already there have been exchange visits over this issue, and you know, I'm a very optimistic person. So using that optimism, I think one day Uganda Cooperative College will be a university.
Yes, of course, that is our prayer, because the Inter-University Council of East Africa has actually a mobility program, in other words, an exchange program.
Right.
Yes, where an institution that does not have a particular expert, you can apply to Inter-University Council of East Africa, and they can send those people to always come in. Yes, they can be seconded by the East African community, and actually also paid by the East African community to render that particular service. Now, Augustine, let's look at the young people. You know, young people are fond of despising things even they don't know, things that are meant to benefit them. So how do we get them to appreciate, love cooperative education, that even when they are outside school, they should pick interest in getting the ABCDs of cooperative education, because actually it would be guiding them on what to do next.
Thank you very much. You see, in the beginning I said cooperative societies is a product of relationships. And in my view, the challenge that we have now is the issue of attitudes. If you look at our society carefully, how it is structured, you actually realize that in the 1960s, 70s, 80s, there was a strong bonding amongst community members arising from issues that were uniting them. The relationships were based on issues. Mm-hmm. What were the concerns of society at that time? How would we address them collectively? It was a practice of the people at that time. However, from the time the world and Africa adopted capitalism, it has brought the spirit of selfishness. It has brought the spirit of individualism. Mm-hmm. So you find that everyone, whatever the person is doing, they're actually looking at how do I benefit as a person?
As a person. Not how do we develop together.
How do we develop together? Yeah. The spirit of how do we develop together actually died. If it has not died, it must be on ICU. Why? Mm-hmm. Because society has completely got affected by the Western practice. And I think, to some extent, I blame African leaders for having accepted to totally embrace capitalism. Without putting safeguards. Mm-hmm. Why? Because when you look at communities that have sustained their original structure, community setup, if you went to Asian societies mm-hmm. that have preserved their culture, you actually realize that it is easy to put two people together to develop together. Why? Because that is the way of life. Today, you find that a person is assuming he's walking on the road, he finds somebody having got accident, he does not care because he's not the one who got accident. So he can be able to even pass that person and continue moving with his business. Why? Because life has become so individualistic. And I think...
Was Ndogo Augustine, time is not our best yes. ally? I'll wish in 1 minute?
In 1 minute.
You conclude as you give your
yes,
part in short.
In 1 minute, I want to say that there is a lot that must be done in today's generation that I belong to. We must educate and continue educating and always educate to ensure that we change the mindsets of our people and be able to allow them network socially so that we can be able to build organizations, cooperatives that can be able to transform and propel us economically.
Yeah, thank you very much, Ndogo Augustine Otuko. Yes, Francis Mluana.
Yes.
Yes, in a minute.
Thank you so much.
Your parting shot.
Like
your
you said earlier, there is no country which is better than its people. Mm. There cannot be good cooperatives without well-trained personnel in cooperative affairs. So the cooperative college will continue to play its role because as we see now, there is revival and resuscitation of the cooperative system in our environment. Thank you.
Well, I must thank you very much, Ndogo Francis Mluana, for really traveling all the way from Chigumba, actually, to come and be with us on this program, because it has been crucial and very important, given that today we join the rest of the world to celebrate the International Cooperative Day. And Ndogo Augustine Otuko, yes, thank you for giving this a political touch, because ideally, as Kwame Nkrumah said, seek first the political kingdom. And as he's put it right, that in Kenya and Tanzania, their cooperative colleges had the political will. So that's why NRM and, of course, people in government should have the will to develop cooperative education in this country. Amanda Akol Mazima, saying bye-bye.